future meeting, and HRAC has agreed to that. We will then vote positions as appropriate on November town meeting warrant articles, and then review the Board of Selectmen 2016 meeting schedule and approve minutes for September 15th, 2015. And with that, I will start liaison reports. Mr. Arena.
Nothing to report.
Okay, Mr. Berman.
A couple of things. I attended a few outside meetings in the last couple of weeks. Most recently, this week, it was the 40th anniversary of the Mystic Valley Elder Service, and they had a really nice, soiree, and which I attended. And it's an incredible to look at some of the things that that organization does. And as many of you may know, they've also merged with a group in Chelsea, so now they're kind of larger and kind of going through some of those growing pains. But what was great is that they had different people who work there sort of tell the stories of what they do, from the person who drives the Meals on Wheels to the intake person, and just really kind of the heartfelt stories about some of the day-to-day struggles of providing services to our most needy residents. So that was a real learning experience for me, and I'm glad I attended. I also attended one of the library building committees, again, just sort of working through. Looks like the building is, they've solved some of the issues with the drainage, made some changes that looks like that's still well within the contingency, probably pushed back a couple of months in terms of, because they're not going to be able to finish all the site work in time for the winter, because the asphalt plant shut down. But other than that, it seems like it's still slugging along, and if you know, you drive by there every day, you'll see them a little more progress. So
very good.
So far, so good. A couple other things, but I can't remember.
All right, Kevin.
I attended the Human Relations Advisory. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, and yeah. One more thing.
Before you forget again.
Before, thank you, Mr. Manager. I also attended the Arcasa had a viewing of a film that was funded through the Wahlberg, Donnie Wahlberg Foundation. Actually, Jim Wahlberg, his brother, put together a film called If Only. And basically, in a dramatic fashion, it was held actually at Jordan's, to a full house, by the way. There had to be over 400 people there. A lot of kids, a lot of teenagers, a lot of parents. It was filmed locally, I think in Tewksbury. And it told the story of just, you know, kids and families struggle with addiction to narcotics, OxyContin and heroin and things like that. And it was a dramatic movie, a lot of wet eyes in the house. But it really sort of focused the light on some of the things that communities are done. And then they also had a kind of after the movie sort of a open conversation with some providers and experts in the field. And of course, things like that, it raises more questions than gives answers. But what it really is doing is putting the focus, you know, out of shame and out of sort of the closet, but really into the forefront about that this really is a community problem. And the more things like this that get out, the more we're going to be able to deal with this. It's really a scourge. It's an epidemic, and it was to a full house on a weekday night with lots of kids there. And I just think, you know, we should be really proud of the work Arcasa does in this community to kind of bring people together and to bring this issue to the fore. So that was well worth attending, and I hope, Bob, I don't know if it's possible to through Arcasa to get that screening done in the schools or for other places, but it was very impactful.
Was that was promoted well outside of Reading, I assume? I
think yes, so. There was some, yeah. In fact, there was, I think, a large group from Tewksbury came. It's where the movie was filmed.
Sure, yeah. Okay.
And, but still, it was a lot of Reading folks.
Sounds like the sort of thing you want to make sure it gets a lot of play, right?
Yeah. It was great. I mean, it was a great film in and of itself,
right.
But just the mission of Arcasa and you know, trying to put some answers together, I think is something that.
If I could jump in, there's a very touching scene at the end. One of the youths actually dies of an overdose. They show the funeral, and what they did was the producers, they asked folks from all over the state who had lost family members to participate in the filming. So they came, they sat in the church. There was a real coffin that was wheeled in, and at the very end of the movie, about 20 pictures of people that had passed were shown by those people that came to the funeral. And it was a very gripping way to end the movie. So it's very impactful. I agree, Barry, that's a great report. Thanks. Okay.
I met with the Human Relations Advisory Committee at their most recent meeting. It's actually a well-attended meeting. It was good. It was also with them, besides the members of the committee, were three student liaisons from the high school. They did they put together a little comparison of dialogue to mix into groups and to see how different people reacted to different, you know, a person they haven't met before and different dialogues, which was actually a very interesting thing to be part of. One of the bigger topics that we wanted to discuss, and the direct reason why we've changed them from being on our meeting tonight, is I wanted to go in and discuss a little bit more with them in regards to communication policies. So they seem to come up with, as a group effort, I think come up with a direction to put them in, and they wanted to take a little bit more time to go back and say, okay, with this, let us regroup, not just come in tonight, but come in a later meeting so we can do a little bit more homework on our end to that end. I think it's going to, in the end, be a good compromise. So I look forward to actually having that meeting with them on November 3rd, I believe, is when they're going to be coming back to meet with us.
Very good.
Also in tonight in office hours, we had a resident that came in that wanted to establish a commission on disability. This is something, I guess, that the name itself is a state compliance term, where she had gone to the state and they said, okay, well, you need to send that back to your commission on disability, and what we have is a ADA coordinator. And she said, oh, you mean our ADA coordinator? And they said, no, it has to be a commission on disability person that handles it. It might just be a state thing, might not, but I thought it was actually a pretty interesting idea for us to look into. This would be something that's dealing with moving forward, and not only just from a standpoint of economic development, if there are going to be new buildings or rehab buildings, what they might be, something to make sure that we are doing everything we can to make sure that our residents are able to stay in Reading comfortably. You know, we've talked about that, I think, from a standpoint of housing. Wouldn't be bad to talk to, you know, have the discussion and maybe form this commission to look into ways to do that, both with things in the realm of even closed captioning for RCTV. It wouldn't just be something particular to a building, but something maybe particular to, you know, what we do with the parking lots at crosswalks, certainly, you know, ADA compliance with renovations of buildings moving forward, that kind of thing. There seem to be some small minor things that get missed even through ADA compliance, and I think that was the reason why this was kind of being aired as maybe a good commission for this board to start. So that was during the office hours tonight.
Very good. Did you get a sense of whether or not this commission had to be a freestanding commission, or whether it could be another board sitting as the commission as needed?
The thought was, you know, you maybe have members on there that are architects, local real estate agents, maybe even as far as police, fire, board of selectmen liaison, obviously, building department.
It could that be an adjunct responsibility of the PBC? I'm just thinking that through.
That was the other part that we kind of put
a big overlap.
We thought about. Yeah, it seems there wasn't anything that said, "Hey, this is what it should be."
Yeah.
It was more, you know, there's a need for this out there, and whatever form this this board, you know, decides to what extent to work with that is something that the person brought in would be very happy.
You're not limiting it to building or new construction.
No. It'd be anything involving basically, you know, folks that are that have a disability of one kind or another.
Could be signage, could be messaging, could be
right.
Website, could be.
Yep.
All right.
So yeah. I thought it was an interesting point, something we should probably definitely take a look at and maybe see, work through the how, the what, the where.
Bob, is that something Matt could help us with?
Hey, there he is.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I think Laura is the ADA coordinator.
Okay.
Right behind you.
Well, you can delegate.
Yeah.
Feel free.
Put her on it as well. She comes under my office. But yeah, I can look into it for you guys.
Thank you very much.
What if there's other towns that have this already?
That's what I was
structured.
That's a great, I thought, yeah.
I know Methuen has it. That's That's where I come from, the Disabilities Commission.
Well, they must, since the state has that term,
yeah,
Commission on Disability, as a set, you know, you person to go see in your town or city.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so other towns do.
Okay. That's all I have.
Thanks, Kevin. John Halsey, tell the world you're doing fine, and is there anything you'd like to report?
Well, I've been kind of out of commission for most of the last month.
Understood,
so,
yep.
I'm ready to get back into action, believe me. I'm sitting watching you on TV and talking to you on the phone and wishing I was out of my house. I've been locked up here for over 3 weeks, so soon to be out. And good. Just put everybody on notice. Another week or so, I'll lose again.
We'll have Kevin read the public notice. And you'll be on the lookout for John Halsey. Thanks, John, and speedy healing. Okay, I have a few items. A number of us attended the financial forum with the school committee and finance committee on 9/16. An important vote was taken that night. The school committee and the selectmen voted to accept the new facility department reorganization. I thought that was a big step forward, seeing the and the FinCom also. So the all three boards are in sync on that, and that's great to see. September 23rd, the Permanent Building Committee Appointment Committee, consisting of myself, moderator Alan Folds, and school committee chair Chuck Robinson, met, and we appointed a number of folks, and for the public's edification, I will give you the names. Greg Stepler, who is a U.S. Naval Academy grad and works for Turner Construction, was appointed. He is also designated this evening as chair of that committee. Patrick Tompkins, who is a business owner and a structural engineer and construction management person, works for CTA Construction Company, was also appointed. Nancy Toomey, a very well-known town meeting member, a longtime participant in town issues, currently serving on the Library Building Committee, was appointed. John Coote, who in years past served on the Zoning Board of Appeals. John is a retired structural engineer. He was a principal at his former company, and I think he'll bring a lot of corporate memory to the whole process here. And the last permanent member is Brad Congdon, who is a construction project manager. He actually went to school with one of my kids. Works for a company named ECC, who does mostly government and DOD type work, so he should not be seeing any kind of conflict. And we also appointed one associate that evening. This committee will have two eventually. That person is Michael Bean, who is a commercial project manager with Bond Brothers. We will be meeting again, the PBC appointment committee, on, Monday the 19th to appoint the remaining member. In addition, as I mentioned, I attended the RACASA annual meeting with Barry. I think he gave a great report on that. And last night, this may be the first time this has been discussed publicly, Bob and I attended the North Reading town meeting, on which was both a report and a article on taking the first phase of joining the North Reading water system to the MWRA. We have been in discussions with their selectmen, a sub-quorum of that board, for about a year now. It looks like, I don't know how the vote went last night, but they're trying to get design money for the first phase of wheeling MWRA water up Main Street through Reading to North Reading. They currently are supplied by Andover and I believe wells in the Ipswich River. That supply is insufficient for their future needs. They're looking to do a lot of economic development, but they're actually being hamstrung by their water supply right now. Plus, Andover is not really interested in providing more water, and they're in a lot of difficulty on that side of the negotiation. So it looks like this could be a real win-win for both North Reading and Reading, and we're going to proceed depending on that vote of town meeting last night. Let's see. Yeah.
Does that mean tearing up North Main Street?
No, that's all been pre-programmed.
Okay.
They made that pipe 2 inches bigger, just in case. Okay. Not at all.
Just there, South Main Street.
There might be additional piping required in North Main. We will not redo what we did. Okay. No. God forbid. I think pitchforks and torches would light up all over the place.
The only way to get out of Reading then would be by helicopter.
Great. One other, just a couple upcoming things. I mentioned the 10:19 appointment session for the final PBC member. There's also an MAPC session tomorrow night for those who are interested at the RMLD meeting room on Ash Street. The doors open at 6:30. Sandwiches will be served. And a number of us are attending that meeting. And that's all I have to report. So I guess that concludes our reports. Is there any public comment on any item not on the agenda tonight? Okay, I don't see any. Bob, do you have?
Just two quick things that you folks didn't cover. There's a handout tonight showing that the meals tax history has returned over $1.5 million to the town in the 3 or 4 years since it was instituted.
That's great.
You know, in real numbers, that's $1 million in the school budget and $500,000 in the town. It wouldn't have been there, so eat up.
Page four?
Yeah, it's in tonight's page four.
Especially to have the out-of-towners come in anymore.
Yeah, that's the best, yes. and the other thing was today I had the privilege of attending Sergeant Farr's funeral at the Congregational Church next door with Representatives Jones and Dwyer. And I'd like to really tip my hat to VSO Kevin Bowmiller, who organized along with Matt Cornelis a really nice service today, a really nice ceremony. There was a lot of logistics, a lot of moving parts.
Yep.
And, you know, I had the family step aside and talk to me last week and said they had heard from the different folks in the Army that were involved in this that it's been the nicest one they've ever attended. That especially the return to Reading with the two fire engines and the flag and all the people, there must have been a couple hundred people out waving flags, was something they had never seen before. So I really commend the community for, showing the Vars family that respect.
And I noticed it received media attention on it was either Channel 4 or 5 this evening, so that's awesome.
Okay.
Great job by one and all, and we're really glad to have Kevin on the team.
Yes, that's all I have. Thank you, Dan.
You too. Okay, proceeding right along here. Let's move to our next item, which is discussing the old AccuVote machines and approving the new ones. Laura, would you like to make a few comments before we take a vote?
Did you guys receive the letter? So, as I stated in the very beginning of this whole process, this was definitely not an easy decision. And the letter that I stated shows the dollar amounts, and it turns out that LHS is just a little bit cheaper than ES&S. Personally, I think LHS will do us justice. They've been serving us for 20 years with the AccuVote machines. So along with the election workers and their opinions and some of the town clerks that attended, I believe the best way to go would be the ImageCast machine with LHS.
Very good. Any questions from the board on that? This is on page 5. Yes.
Laura, what training, what startup training or to bring the election workers up to speed with the new equipment, what do you expect that'll take in terms of time and money?
LHS has committed to come out and set up a training session at our convenience to train both myself and the election workers. What I would recommend that we do is that we'll have the wardens, and the clerks and the assistant wardens show up to that training, and then I will at that point train everybody else as well. So there'll be several training sessions prior to, one conducted by LHS and several conducted by myself. And on election day, LHS will have a representative here the entire election day for the first election in case we run into trouble.
Good.
Thank you, Barry.
Laura, given that we move the election up to March 1st, will that be enough time to get the machines worked, programmed, poll workers trained, everything up and running?
Yes. We have to place the order within the next week. Like next week, the order will have to be replaced. And I have to let the state know by November 1st. And I'll be letting them know tomorrow.
Okay. Are these like ready-to-go machines? We're not talking about going back to a factory and building them, right?
Correct.
So they're in stock somewhere.
Correct. The only thing that that needs to be done is we have two auto mark machines, the machines that are used to mark the ballot for the handicapped.
Yes.
Those have to be reprogrammed.
Okay.
So I'll have to get ES&S out here to reprogram those two machines, and we have until
contact with you?
February, to get that done.
So in case they want to vote absentee, they can. Are those machines available here if they want to vote absentee, or is that not an issue usually?
We generally don't set the machines up on until Election Day.
Yeah.
We could, but we'd have to set them up in a conference room somewhere.
Well, if it's historically not been an issue. But
correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
Correct.
Yes.
Historically, we have about 4 or 5 citizens that use those machines regularly.
The old machines?
Mm-hmm.
Are we going to keep a couple around, like for spare tires kind of thing? Or?
We can't. They have to go back.
So,
because once the vote is made tonight, we can no longer use the AccuVote machines at all.
Okay.
So, we can't have an election until we get the image casts in place.
So, what if the doomsday scenario happens? We don't get the machines in time.
There won't be one.
There won't be one.
There will not be.
No, because the order will be placed within the next couple weeks. They'll be here. Worst case scenario is I need to talk to the state and we'll have to do a paper ballot.
Okay. Is there any secondary value to the machines we're taking out of commission to some other community or the vendor in terms of rehabbing them?
The machines themselves, they are for us because we're returning them and getting a credit.
Okay.
All right.
The black boxes that the machines set on, there are a couple of communities that have shown interest in using those because you can't get them anymore.
Okay.
North Reading being one of them, they'd like a couple.
Good.
Unless there's an objection, I planned on giving them to the communities that could use them.
Okay.
Good, thank you.
All right, any other questions from the board? If not, Mr. Secretary, we have a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen discontinue the use of the old AccuVote machines effective immediately.
You have a second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor? Discussion? All in favor?
You're going to need to vote by roll call.
Oh, yeah.
I forgot. Sorry about that. All right, Mr. Arena.
Yes.
Mr. Berman.
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. And Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Thank you. That's 5-0. And that's it.
Would you like a motion?
We need to vote.
Oh, we need the other one. Yep. Go ahead. Yep.
Don't it's the doomsday scenario.
Don't stop. Scenario.
Gotcha.
We have a lot of power right now.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, let's see. Do we want to vote or don't we?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the use of the ImageCast machine effective immediately.
Okay, seconded. Okay, Mr. Berman.
Yes.
Mr. Sexton.
Yes.
Mr. Arena.
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger. Yes. Mr. Halsey.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Laura. I think we're all set.
Thank you.
Good
thank
luck.
You.
What are those machines?
We're counting on you now.
No pun intended.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Item 6B is the request to revoke a prior approval for a second driveway at 181 South Street. Bob, could you give us the background on that?
And the applicant is here.
I see.
Tom Wise.
Yeah.
Tom was before the board quite a while ago to ask for approval for a second driveway, which a prior board granted. He's since had a change in his plan, and one of the conditions from the Zoning Board of Appeals was actually to have the selectman revoke that permission just so that second driveway cannot be put in as originally envisioned. And I'll turn it over to Tom if you have any other comments to make.
I guess it's, as town manager knows, it's part of a settlement of an appeal against the zoning board and against myself. That appeal is specifically tied to that second driveway, and it's specifically tied to the process we went through to get that second driveway. So after you hopefully approve revoking that second driveway, I would encourage you with town council to figure out if special permits are applicable to driveways or not, because the case is essentially asserting that there was not proper notification of the second driveway when we first met with you guys a while ago. Rather than fight that in court, I'm gonna give that up myself, but that would be something I would ask you to consider when and or look at the legal opinion of, so that nobody else has to go through what I went through. But essentially, I'm taking that driveway away, reconfiguring the way in which we're doing the work, and my neighbor is stipulating to hold the appeal, settle the appeal so we can move forward with everything once all of this is done.
Okay. Well, we're sorry that all happened, and we'll do what we can tonight to move the process forward.
You guys, as far as I'm concerned, you didn't do anything wrong from what you knew, and I didn't do anything wrong from what I knew. I think it's just, I think within the appeal and all the paperwork that's there, there's some legal precedent that maybe should be looked at and understood.
So it was our decision that got appealed to the ZBA? Is that
your decision could not be appealed because it was past time,
okay,
essentially. Because in his case, his assertion more or less is, and his lawyer could clarify it further, is that there wasn't proper notification because there was not a butter notification for the second driveway. It was the normal notification within, in the newspaper was very generic, basically like that. It was on one of these, but it wasn't in the newspaper. It didn't go in the email. It didn't go into the mail to people. So he didn't feel like he was properly notified. So he couldn't appeal it then. The only thing he could appeal was the actual final zoning board decision, because the stipulation of the zoning board decision was that you guys had already approved the driveway, which you did. And so that was his recourse. You want to add anything?
I just want to clarify that those are all allegations the town council and myself may not agree with.
Yes.
That was the suit that was brought, and those were the allegations made.
How long ago was this?
So the original agreement from you was in February of 2014. You reaffirmed that in March of this year.
Right.
And the zoning board agreed to it at the end of May. The appeal was filed on June 12th, and we're trying to get through the settlement process now.
So Bob, you would assert that there was no defect in noticing?
I'd rather not say. We just don't agree with the way the complaint was filed.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, you know, we want to resolve, you know, your issue, but in terms of, you know, are there any things that we as a board need to take away from this process will have an impact on anything else going forward?
John Halsey, is everything coming through clearly tonight? Pretty much? Just checking with you. Still there? Oh, that's true.
Yeah. Muted.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I would agree with Mr. Lasher.
I'm here. I just have to, you know.
Yeah, got it.
You know, our advanced technology requires me to watch TV with the sound on, not listen.
Yeah, I got it.
Then when you ask me something, I got to reverse the mute. And so, you know, it's not so simple to answer, but I am getting everything.
That's what I wanted.
Although somewhat delayed.
Okay, do you have any questions regarding the issue of the discontinuance of the driveway?
I do not.
Okay.
The only other point I'll make, just for your edification, and maybe Mr. Lasher knows different as well, my understanding of the reason why it's a stipulation of the zoning board's approval of the minor change is because of the Summer Street issue, and there was a legacy curb cut issue there that they wanted to make sure that there's no legacy curb cut issue here, and so your revoking of it means that there's no legacy curb cut issue, and therefore they don't have a problem 20 years down the road.
Okay, any other questions by the board?
Nope.
If not, let's proceed to the motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen revoke the March 18, 2014 approval of the second driveway for 181 South Street.
Okay, seconded?
Second.
Okay, poll the board. John Arena?
Yes.
Barry?
Yes.
Kevin?
Yes.
I vote yes. And John Halsey, how do you vote?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right. We will continue to work this the best we can. Thank you for coming in. Yeah. Thanks.
I don't blame you at all.
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Yeah. We could take up the minutes while we're waiting for the hearing here. September 15th, 2015. Can we have a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of September 15th, 2015, as amended.
Second.
Seconded. Any comments, changes?
I've given Paula a minor change already, which she'll put into the minutes.
Okay, can you just give us a summation of what it was?
Yes, it was a characterization of whether a delay would put the... This went to the matter of the Tread Athletic Club.
Oh, yeah.
And my characterization, my statement was that giving them a trial period would put the Board of Selectmen in the position of being the bad guys, potentially, if there was a dispute, a continuing dispute between the two parties. It was.
Yep, that's my recollection.
It was described a little differently than that, but it's been corrected.
Okay.
That's my recollection.
Any other comments? John Halsey, any comments on the minutes?
Nope. They're fine as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you very much. All right, I will take... I will take the vote. Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Grumman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
I vote yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Okay, the minutes are approved. And I think we have come to the appointed... close enough hour for the public hearing. Kevin, you want to read the notice?
Please take note, to the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on October 6, 2015 at 8 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on approving amendments to the non-union FY16 classification plan. Copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on October 6, 2015 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you, Kevin. Okay, Bob, you want to walk us through?
Certainly, thank you. On tonight's packet, it's pages 7 and 8. I'll start, instead of doing one position at a time, I think there's some groups here that make sense to discuss them together, so I'll do that. As we discussed at that financial forum in September, the reconfiguration of the facilities department also has some new positions, or some changed positions. The first is adding to grade M, as in mouse, facilities director position that was previously under the school's budget, so it wasn't in your classification plan. The next one is to add back a assistant facilities director. The schools had to remove that, I think it was 3 years ago in their budget process. We'll propose to add that in grade J. And that'll be subject, I request that you add it tonight, but in order to hire someone, that's subject to town meeting vote and approval of funding in November. Lastly, it's a change from a vacant business analyst position to upgrade that, again, subject to funding a town meeting to a purchasing agent. The town is actually taking on a fair amount of back office work, if you will, by taking on the facilities department. We expect good help from the schools and have certainly received that through the winter. But at some point in the spring and the summer, certainly we'll be more on our own, if you will, from a back office standpoint. Our current business administrator, who subsequently has been hired as the DPW assistant director, was spending well over half of her time on procurement, as it was. So I believe the addition of facilities turns that into a full-time position. Therefore, the request is to upgrade by a couple grades a business analyst position to a purchasing agent. So those are the changes related to the facilities specifically. For pay in class, there were only two actions that require board approval. I've listed them here. One is the addition of a recreation administrator. We have found that John Feudo, by assuming the role of community services director, is involved substantially less in recreation activities, and the recreation staff runs themselves very well. But effectively, this would be a promotion of a couple grades for an existing program coordinator. She's well qualified and very anxious to have this position. And I will say parenthetically that historically, John Feudo has trained number two people excellently, and then they all leave within a couple of years and become rec director somewhere else. So it'd be nice to keep someone.
Sure.
We'd like to keep that existing position open just in case in a future budget we can fill it, but we have no desire to fill it now. It may or may not be proposed as part of FY17's budget. Somewhat similarly, the senior case manager, we have a highly qualified person that clearly is doing work above the grade that this position was anticipated to be. And we'd like to keep the old case manager position in there because I would say that will be a request in FY17, but we'd like to give this person an opportunity to be more of a management level case supervisor. So those are the only two changes that are requested for you for the pay in class results. We do have a slug of money to move around within town meeting, and you'll see that as we go over the warrant. And these are all, if you will, self-funded by the money that's already in the budget. Lastly, there's a group of what I called other changes. The first two are fairly simple. We want to rename the appraiser to assessor and assistant appraiser to assistant assessor. And then secondly, an important thing that we discussed quickly at the financial forum in September, another area the schools and the town worked on jointly this summer was HR. We each have an HR lead person, a director. They're each tremendously overworked, and they just need help. Rather than add two half-time people or try to afford two full-time people, we discussed splitting someone. And we think that'll actually work well. They will have a physical location both in central office in the superintendent's area and in town hall. So we're proposing that to be added into the town's budget fully, but we expect them to, as needed, spend at least half their time with schools.
So the town have administrative oversight over that person or the schools?
Yes, it will.
Okay.
They'll certainly have input into that,
right,
but it'll technically be a town position.
Okay. Somebody needs to own it, though.
And just to make it clear, in HR and in payroll especially, you know, town hall does an enormous amount of work for the school department currently. So even while the person may sit here, quite often they'll be dealing with teachers. Particularly with payroll and benefits issues. Benefits has become a really complex area, and I anticipate that a good chunk of this person's work will be to become more of a specialist on benefits. Other towns around us are actually adding a benefits coordinator, and they are doing a similar thing, splitting it with towns and schools, or at least making it available. I think we need someone that's more of a generalist. From discussing this with the superintendent, we want the benefits piece, but we want more. We want to have this person be able to step in for three quarters of the job of either of our directors should they need to be out for any period of time. And lastly, there's a vacant position that we don't anticipate funding for the foreseeable future, so we'd like you to remove assistant building inspector.
Very good. All right, questions from the board?
None.
Are there any questions from the public on the classification plan, non-union FY16 classification? Okay, hearing none. John, do you have any questions? John Halsey?
Give him 5 seconds.
Yeah.
No, I don't.
Okay, great. All right, I will accept the motion to close the hearing.
I just had a quick question.
Okay.
Bob, I know we haven't had an assistant building inspector for a while, but can you just comment on sort of the workload that the full-time building inspector has, and you know, given hopefully anticipating new building in town, given some of the economic development we want to do, is that a position you see down the road that we might need?
Anything is possible. Right now, just so you know, our building inspector actually retired this summer and is now working. We wouldn't let him fully retire. He's working part-time. So, and in addition, another community's building inspector retired a month before, and he's also working half-time. So we effectively have two very good, seasoned, experienced building inspectors doing one FTE of work. And they can flex their schedule so they can overlap if needed. And we have some funds budgeted for that overlap, as it were, because we have something called, I can't remember, it's a backup building inspector, I think. It was always anticipated that at least 3 or 4 weeks a year the building inspector's on vacation. So we have always hired another building inspector to sub in, and now we have two that are able to do it. We don't know how long that will work. Right now it's working well. If we become so busy that that's not sustainable, we may have to make one of those a full-time position and have 1.5 building inspectors, if you will. But I don't think there's a need to ever call it assistant building inspector at this point. And for funding reasons, depending on what it is, we do have a permits revolving fund. If another large project comes to town, you know, such as the proposed 40B down by the train station, we could put the permit fees into that fund. We'd have to go through town meeting to get that authorized, and then have a pot of money to pay staff that would be working on a project like that.
Is there any kind of feedback from the community that, you know, that what we have is adequate, or are there people waiting a long time to get their permits?
There's been no change in the waiting or the delays. You know, people would always like to have something sooner, but I don't think there's any noticeable change from the two that we happen to have. You know, if we had two different ones, maybe.
Bob, knowing something about the individuals, do you think we'd get enough of a heads up if their status changed?
Yeah. I'm not sure we'd let the status change.
Okay. Thank you. Motion to close the hearing if there are no further questions.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on amending the non-union FY16 classification plan.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Okay. Poll the board. Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Thank you. And another motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the amendment to the non-union FY16 classification plan as presented.
Seconded?
Second.
Okay, Mr. Arena seconds. Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
The vote is 5-0. The motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's move on to going through the November town meeting warrant articles, taking positions as appropriate on each article. Bob, you want to walk us through things here?
Certainly. Yeah. I'll start with Article 3, which is changes to capital.
Yep.
This was previewed at the financial forum. I don't think we need to go over it greatly. You know, the board may or may not want to take a position on this. Normally, Article 5 is something you do take a position on. Capital can go either way. Here is that $2 million cemetery garage in italics at the bottom, Dan. And I've just noted to see Article 13 for a full discussion. So the only thing I do want to point out, and this was in time for the financial forum, but it was not expected, is the generator at the Main Street Fire Station blew out. So we really do need to replace that. That's somewhat important. Right now, we are planning on the $60,000 November town meeting transfer. That should be adequate. If the glue that's holding it together right now does not work, we may have to go to FinCom for a reserve fund transfer to really get this nailed. But for now, I think this plan works. There's also some work down at the DPW yard for the fuel canopy and a suppression system. An inspection by the fire department primarily revealed some things that really should be changed. And the light department and the town looked at a three-year history of fuel use and allocated the cost that way. And RMLT was very gracious to agree to pay their share, which actually was more than half, which was interesting. So this is the town share.
Oh, you lost him?
Might have, yeah.
Hang on.
All right, hold on.
You got his number there? You,
yeah, I do.
Just hit redial.
991.
Doing it, yep.
Even better.
Hello.
Hi, John. I think we dropped you, or you dropped us, so you're back.
I've been sitting here and just got lost. So I
think we okay. You or
dropped. Now we know why you mute.
All right. So you're back. Good.
Okay.
Very good. Okay. We're in the middle of discussing the warrant now.
The other thing I'd like to just draw your attention to is the sewer fund. We had two sewer station rehab projects on the capital plan that were approved last year. We bid the project out, and it could not be done for the funds that were allocated. And there was a significant cost increase. This doesn't happen that often, but it did in this case. It's not the kind of work we do very typically, so our estimate up front was just poor. We've redone the capital plan for November town meeting for all other sewer projects to reflect this cost, and it seemed prudent to spread it out over more time because there's no reason why we have to pass this cost along. It's a long-term asset. So $780,000 were turned back to sewer reserves last year because we couldn't complete the project. So we're effectively asking for that money and another $400,000 to do the work that's necessary.
Bob, is your assessment that it was sized improperly, or that the market moved?
It was just a bad estimate. I don't think there's any one part of that. It was off by 60%. It needed to be increased by 60%. Sometimes markets change, but that's unusual.
It's a high change.
Just because we haven't done it in such a long time.
You know, we went through a consultant and they just didn't nail it the first time.
Yeah. Okay.
It isn't something that's common, even in other communities.
Okay. Bob, regarding the, I do see the $2 million for the cemetery board, and I don't want to take a vote till we're done discussing everything.
Okay.
In the event that, and you might want to go through a little bit of the background for the public here. So they're the Board of Cemetery Trustees, they've already voted this article.
The Board of Cemetery Trustees have voted to put what is Article 13 on the warrant, which you've closed. And it requests a $2 million cemetery garage with funding to be split into three pieces. And it's, other than the funding source, it's an identical article to what was brought last April to town meeting.
So this is going to be taken up by both the Permanent Building Committee and the FinCom. Has the FinCom rendered a vote yet?
They will vote next Wednesday night, a week from tomorrow.
Wednesday. what's the proper process? Let's say the board just hypothetically wanted to take a position but advocate design funds only. How would that proceed with our votes tonight? How should it?
I guess the best way to do it would be to move to accept everything other than that line, which mm-hmm. you've done in the past. Peter brought something to the board once that there was one thing in there the board did not want to do, which was downtown phase two by Haven Street.
Yep.
So they moved to approve everything but that one line okay. and then voted that line separately.
Yep.
In this case, rather than just vote against it, you may want to amend the number to some smaller number if you want.
Well, we could do that on the floor. Yeah.
You could
we don't know
if
the number
the
is now. Yeah.
That's true.
Okay.
You could do that on the floor.
But would you amend the purpose of it, if not the amount?
Yeah, you would do both, I think.
I think if you're interested in not approving the $2 million line,
I am.
We can certainly put text into town meeting members mm-hmm. to explain why,
yes,
what your thought
like
process
right.
is. And I don't think you need to make any other motions tonight other than just to explain to town meeting what the thinking is.
So yeah. So if we vote not to include that, does that render Article 13 moot?
If town meeting agrees.
Yeah,
they're going to vote on Article 3 before they vote on Article
right.
just
13.
They'd have to agree with us.
Yeah.
Right. So in other
yeah.
words, if that passes, then Article 13
well, the
doesn't
motion
even come
would
up.
Be made by the FinCom, right?
I was just going to say, with all due respect, yeah. that $2 million is the default motion.
Yeah.
And FinCom next week can decide to change that. And,
they could.
And in the last instance, they did that. They removed, the board voted to remove a capital item, and FinCom happened to agree.
Okay.
So the default motion is whatever FinCom votes next Wednesday night. So if they like the $2 million, that will be the motion. But
mm-hmm.
at least you'll have your explanation in writing out to town.
We're just taking a position. It's their
right.
It's their motion.
Right.
And we could get input in the meantime from PBC or other people about what a ballpark
sure.
figure might be.
Yep.
Yeah. Can you comment? We could do this on 13. Let's
okay.
Let's keep rolling.
Sure.
Any other questions on Article 3 right now?
Nope.
I think the board sees the way I'm going on
mm-hmm.
this. Okay, Article 4.
Article 4, there's been one other prior year fiscal year bill. It's unusual we have so many. Let me go through each of them just quickly. On September 10th, the fire department was told that some repairs made last January and February to a piece of equipment would not be fully covered by a warranty as had been expected. They are in negotiations, and I believe they'll be successful to effectively have a three-way settlement so that we will have to pay one-third of this cost,
mm-hmm.
Which is, as you can see, about $5,000. The second item, the school department last summer just discovered an old invoice from 2013 that had not been paid and should be. The DPW, similarly, in September, just discovered an invoice from last May and June that should have been paid for legal ads that should have been paid that weren't. And then, the first one is probably certainly financially the most important one. We received a bill in early July for June 15 legal services that we had time to pay, we just didn't have the money. So we had received an estimate from council for the high school project, and it just didn't work out to be a good estimate, or we would have just added money in April if we had needed it. So that's a prior year bill that was well known in advance, just we couldn't afford it. So there's the four bills, prior year bills.
9/10 vote required, I think we'll get it.
Yeah, it's interesting. Last night at North Reading, it said 4/5 vote required, so I'm not quite sure what the difference there is.
10% of it.
Yeah.
and their open town meeting has actually no quorum requirements, which
yes.
is even more mind-blowing.
And one person could be the quorum.
Okay, any questions on Article 5? We'll come back and take votes on these.
I think Article 5 we discussed pretty much at the financial forum. I don't, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. The FinCom transfer, that night FinCom, if you do not know, did vote $75,000 to the modular project. It's still not complete. I can't say whether or not those funds will be needed, but FinCom certainly would like, if you will, that $75,000 to be put back into their reserve fund. And I think it's reasonable to add another $75,000, if for nothing else than for our legal bills. We just don't know where the TLT litigation is going, and we don't have a big cushion in that department.
Question?
Yes, John.
Bob, in Article 5 on lines K92 and I think K94, I mean, if you don't do the, some of these expenses are one-timers, like paying class, but if you don't do road painting this year, you're going to have to do it next year, the year after. Ditto on street lighting. Is it really prudent to defer those expenses, or is it truly a decrease, or is it simply a deferral for a year or two?
The road line painting is actually an addition. We do want to do that. And that's a lot of that's brought on by the construction, as you can imagine, that's going on, but mm-hmm. not all of it. The fuel is actually, we just, you know, with the price of gas, we have a fuel budget that's too high. So we can reduce that by 50,000, but keep 40,000 in the department for those two other purposes.
I'm sorry, you're absolutely right. The painting is in, but thing like the lighting expenses, would you cut that out?
That's again, that's an item that for a couple of years has just been over budget, and okay. there's just no need to keep it that high, and the same with trash. Now, it could be we're needing to put out an RFP this winter for rubbish, and you know we don't know beyond June what it'll
happens.
Cost, but we know this year it'll be fine. And you know, it, you know me well enough to know we're leaving a cushion in all of these lines.
Yep.
So the bottom line, and I did get an update from our assessors today at 4 o'clock. We will also have a minimum of another $100,000 in new growth by the time this goes to town meeting floor. Cool. We may have more than that, but we have at least 100,000 more.
How close are we to a free cash total for FY15?
Very close. Sharon's done it three ways and comes up with a $1,500 difference. So that's close enough for me, but not quite for Sharon.
Can you share? You can't share that yet?
Okay. Slightly more than it had been a year before.
Okay.
So
the use of free cash or the growth?
The net balance in free cash. We used a fair amount last year. Mm-hmm. Snow and ice especially, but
yeah.
There's slightly more free cash than the year before. But recall that we ended up doing the portables with debt. So that
yes.
was going to be a use of free cash, and we decided not to just as well.
Okay. Thank you. Any
and again,
questions?
Sewer reserves are going to pay for that sewer project. And I've included a write-up, which I hope is helpful for town meeting for those that don't know the discussions on the facilities department.
Yeah, I'll be happy to stand up and explain the importance of having that that facility.
Article 6 is the action that this board took on the private public roads,
mm-hmm.
which I think worked out really well for these residents in these six roads.
Do we have, let's see, uh-oh. Did we get dividends for, oh, we did.
Here
okay.
it is, the
yep.
Emerson. Yeah.
Emerson.
Yeah, I'm glad you noticed that.
I thought I saw dead end.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we'd have to amend that. That's fine. A lot of good work.
The board doesn't normally get involved in zoning bylaws,
right.
So let me just tell you about them quickly. This first one is the purpose. That's something that was defeated a year ago, September.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can see there's just very slight changes suggested
yep.
this time. Article 8 is it's probably going to get a lot of discussion, personal wireless service facility. I wouldn't begin to know how to explain this to anyone, so I'll just sit there listening at town meeting in November.
Am I buying your cell phone during this?
I think
yes.
it's not nearly as complex as it reads, is what I've been told.
It's usually the case.
The next one is the aquifer protection, which also, you know, perhaps looks a little bit complex, but I'm told, you know, the town worked very closely with CONSCOM and the DEP and has a really nice result. Apparently, from what I'm told, people are satisfied with. In this one in particular, it's a little difficult to read, so the Bolden cross-out is the formal article, but then we've included just a clean copy so people can just read it through at the bottom here in the background.
That's helpful.
Just simpler to read, so it's a little bit long.
Okay.
Whether you want to take a position on Article 10, even though it's zoning, you may. This is just allowing associate members
yeah.
in the ZBA and the CPDC. The CPDC is allowed one associate member. The ZBA may have two. The CPDC limitation on one is just because of state law.
Well, given that one crosses over into areas where we appoint, it's up to the board. But
it does, and it also was the subject of a prior bylaw that the board would have voted
right.
on, and a charter change that the board would have also voted on. So I don't think it's inappropriate for you to vote on that one. Article 11 is a general bylaw suggestion, again arising from changes of the charter, and it simply points people to the proper section in the charter instead of using any language that's just not necessary. So now there's a very formal and spelled out process for removal. I'm not sure why we need to have this as a bylaw, but it's not a terrible idea. It's just reminding people if you're absent from three or four more successive meetings, that's not a good idea.
Yeah.
In my 15, 20 years as a volunteer and employee, I've not seen that very often. But usually peer pressure solves it. On FinCom, we had an issue once, and the chair just approached the member and said, you really need to resign if you can't come, so he did. So I don't know that you need a bylaw, but sure. Again.
Okay.
Any questions?
No.
Okay. Article 12.
Just a technicality on 11.
Yeah.
Reading the article as it's written here, to see if the town will vote to amend section 3314, they don't say what document. You might want to point that out to Alan.
Okay.
Or whoever's doing the motion to stick okay. Reading bylaws in there.
Yeah, general bylaws. Okay.
Yeah, general bylaws.
Yeah.
Good eyes.
Mm. That is interesting. Article 12. I've not heard more, but as you know from executive session and now public, we're looking to settle this potential litigation for $125,000. I anticipate that to be the final time we need to discuss this.
That would come from free cash.
Yes. It could come from a different source, but free cash makes sense to me.
Sure.
Same with prior year bills.
Rocco lives again.
Article 13 is the cemetery garage, and you can see they have actually formally in the article suggested source of funding $1.2 million from the sale of real estate. $1.2 million from debt. That's borrowing. $700,000 from sale of real estate, which pretty much wipes it out. And then some lesser amount, $100,000 from the sale of cemetery lots. So $2 million total. For the purpose of constructing a cemetery garage and related facility, including site preparation, construction, and so forth. So this article does not specify a site, just to be clear.
Right. I have to confess, I'm very disappointed that the Board of Cemetery Trustees did not see it fitting and appropriate to be before this board tonight on the evening when we're taking a position. I don't know if there's an opportunity to get them onto our next agenda before town meeting,
but
I would certainly like to see them in here. We need to discuss if the board is going to go along with design funds only. We have to be on one page as to how we're going forward here. It would be helpful to be on one page.
It'd be sure helpful to work that out amongst ourselves.
I think it's crucial that we have that meeting with them. Okay. Yes.
I'd like to add, I'm also very disappointed that they heard what they heard at April town meeting and they'd never approached me or the board.
I agree.
To have a discussion about what's the best path forward. They just chose this one. I had no idea it was coming until, a day before you're closing the warrant, I was handed the article.
I'm also disappointed that one or more members of this board suggested alternatives such as outsourcing some of the work they do on the groundskeeping, and it seemed to fall on deaf ears without any discussion between the two groups. So I think we need to.
Yeah. Also, what they submitted was exactly the thing that town meeting
except
6 months
splits.
Ago
yeah.
said it's not ready,
right.
And it didn't appear to work to get done.
So. There's some people telling me they've heard this so many times they just want to vote for it, and I get that. And they're worried about the safety issues in the building. I get that. Bob, can you talk to us a little bit about some of the temporary safety issues that Joe Huggins is working on?
Sure. Also at that town meeting, an instructional motion came from the floor to have the facilities department oversee the building, which it never had before. Mm-hmm. So although there's no budget for it this year, our new facilities director has stepped in a few weeks ago and started to make some safety improvements. We formally inspected it two different ways. Maya came out, our property casualty insurer, and made some suggestions. And then our building inspector and fire chief and fire day officer and some others, myself included, went out and inspected the site. I was more looking, they were more inspecting. The staff has been very creative how they use the space. It's not enough
yes.
space, and it's not used safely. I have a written memo from the fire chief, and I have a verbal discussion from the building inspector, and they both agree the structure is sound. But it is not being used in a safe way, and some things need to change. And certainly some repairs and improvements need to be made. This is no fault of the folks that have worked there. They've had no budget. They've done a great job, but it's almost like a camp. So it's self-repaired.
We don't have to spend $2 million to make this a safe workplace.
No, it'll be nominal money.
Yeah.
So you know, the facilities director is putting in smoke detector, CO detector. Nothing was there. Mm-hmm. The biggest single issue is a wood stove that's going to have to be changed and dealt with for the upcoming winter. There's a couple of possibilities for that.
Does that require any budgetary action?
It's money that the facilities director feels he can find.
Okay.
For now. If it's money he can't find, that's a decision point for us all to sit down and make. But I did ask the cemetery trustees a few years ago when this issue first came up to please let us know if they ever felt from the, if the workers wouldn't tell us, if they would tell the trustees the building isn't safe, please tell us. And the last time I spoke to one of the trustees last spring, he insisted, no, it's not that it's not safe, it's just that it needs to be repaired or fixed. I was concerned from a safety standpoint. You know, once they filed the article again, I said, I need to go look myself because maybe they know something I don't. And I was perfectly willing to shut the building down and close it if it's not safe. Apparently it is fine for now, but again, that wood stove for the winter is potentially a safety issue.
Yes.
That may require the building to be closed if we can't solve it.
And Bob, in an extreme situation, there are alternative places to run the cemetery.
Absolutely.
Out of,
you know, the cemetery operation can be run out of the DPW yard. Now, the DPW yard's already full, but there's no reason on a temporary basis we can't make do.
Mm-hmm.
There's temporary structures you can buy. There's
yep.
temporary structures you can build. The equipment will fit, and the people are not a problem in terms of staffing. You know, the argument I've heard most often from Bill Brown is the equipment, you know, needs to be centrally located because it saves 15 or 30 minutes of transportation time a day. Well, those pieces of equipment need to get fuel, which is down at the yard.
Yep.
And the staff yep. needs to go there for meetings, which is down at the yard. And every other piece of equipment is used by the town, comes from the yard. So, you know, I'm not sure that that's a
so
real
that's strong. That's a matter of management.
So it's not like they're strangers to the
no.
Well, exactly.
No.
Well, they shouldn't be.
You economize your trips and you get it done.
Right.
Okay.
Nor is the route.
So, you know, I'm perfectly willing to consolidate that down there, and we'll have to figure out how. I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but if we have to, we will.
Is there an intermediate position where you could decompress what's up at the cemetery garage and run a fraction of it out of the DPW?
Well, I believe that you could probably keep most of the equipment where it is. It's not the equipment that's not safe. It's the people shouldn't be in there. Get the equipment, go use it, leave it there. But they live there. They stay there. And that's probably the part that shouldn't happen. So if the, you know, if the heating system is not adequate, the equipment's not going to mind. It's the people that are going to mind. So they just shouldn't spend any time there. You know, they have lunchroom and rest facilities and so forth. So, you know, I want to make sure that when this article is discussed, there's no concern for the staff or the safety of the place.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And Article 14. John, do you have anything? John Halsey, don't mean to move too quickly here. If you have anything, just jump in. Okay.
I'm trying to balance the technology here.
Gotcha.
I'm with Waldaway.
Okay, very good.
The next article I don't know a lot about. I have not gone to any of the meetings. John and Kevin have, so I'd ask for your
Yeah,
background.
Kevin, you want to give us a synopsis of maybe some of the deliberations your committee went through and what your work
Certainly.
Product came out?
As you know, we formed this committee, just before the summer. We had a total of five meetings. The basis of the discussions were both based around public safety and as well as property owners' rights. And
yes.
I think the group actually did a really good job of coming up with what you have in front of you here, which is a proposal to scrap our current firearm bylaw and we revised one with new definitions and language that we felt was not only a compromise on both behalves from a property owner standpoint and safety standpoint, a good compromise. But it was also, to a degree, a cleaning up of the bylaw itself. As we got into discussion in regards to our current bylaw, it was proposed to us from town council that if the decision of the group and the will of the group was to change any aspect of it, the better suggestion was to just scrap it all completely.
Yep.
That there were a couple aspects of it that just didn't make a whole lot of sense, and that we could do a better job of defining what it is we want for that bylaw. So this is what you have in front of you is the group had voted to put on the warrant for November.
The major change is in the discharges prohibited section 8912 that you're changing the 500 feet to 1,000 feet from a dwelling or other building. And what's the current public way distance, 150?
Yes.
Are you changing that to 300? Is that the gist of the change?
Correct.
Okay. John Halsey, anything to add there? Or?
No, I think it's just important to note that, you know, in my opinion, this compromise was a common sense compromise that really served the interest of public safety. There are a number of properties that suddenly are not eligible for discharge of firearms. And, you know, from the standpoint of what those are, we've looked at some mapping of those, which will be presented to town meeting, I believe. But, you know, I mean, for example, now, if this passes, you won't be able to stand in the middle of the Stop and Shop parking lot and fire a gun.
Yeah.
Well, there's a surprise. So, you know, I think what was attempted here was a goal to serve the public interest, to listen to all concerns of all parties, and to come up with something that actually had a common sense approach to everyone's rights and privileges. There are still a number of places where firearms can be discharged in a responsible way. They're not near schools, they're not near public ways, and they tend to not be places that are attractive nuisance locations for children. So, you know, I actually think that the work that was done here was very good. And to reiterate Kevin's point, the current situation of the way that this law is written, you know, our town council just told us that it's so poorly written that it needs to be fixed no matter what. And so I think when you put all this together, this is a very straightforward way to serve the public interest and to serve the rights of all concerned in this issue.
And I just add on to that as well, that in section 8.9.1.3 of the proposed bylaw, which is the last paragraph section, that this is details the authorized discharges in town. Obviously, use of such weapons in the lawful defense of any person, family, yep, or property, any law enforcement officer or member of the armed forces acting within the scope of lawfully authorized duties,
right,
or the use of such weapons on any lawfully permitted target, trap, or skeet range. Those are all going are authorized discharges of firearms.
And
still,
it's worth noting you had both gun proponents, hunters on your committee, and you had,
correct,
residents in the neighborhoods and other citizens.
We actually had an excellent committee,
yeah,
that not only knew just some of our town background, but also a lot of state
yes,
background as in regards to firearms.
Very good. Okay, well done, gentlemen. Appreciate your efforts on this, John and Kevin. Okay, let's take, if there are no further questions on the content, we can go ahead and take positions on the articles. Can we have a motion on Article 3?
You know, can we,
yeah,
Dan,
sure.
I'm sorry, could we step back one?
Yes, absolutely.
Just so that I'm clear, this cemetery article, I think it's Article 13.
Yes.
So I guess a couple of questions come up in my mind. One of them is, Bob mentions that, you know, we've got documented issues of not necessarily the building being unfit to be used, but it being possibly used in an unsafe way. And so my first question is, just from a common sense standpoint, why is that being allowed, number one? It sounds like number two, we've got the situation available that we could either do something on a temporary basis,
right,
or on a much less expensive basis if this building is sound.
Yes.
So am I right about all everything that I heard?
Yes.
You know, that, I mean, I just want to clarify because I'm, as I said, I'm balancing the technology a little bit here, and I want to be sure I didn't miss anything.
Well, I think you got the gist.
Okay. Let me give you
And so when we're voting, are we going to vote on these one by one?
One by one.
Or vote on them as a group?
Why don't we take up 13 first, since we're on that subject now? Bob, you had something to add there?
I just wanted to give you an example. The cemetery division has put some temporary storage, a trailer, on the property.
Yeah, I saw that.
And they have all the vehicles with fuel in the trailer for overnight storage. Mm-hmm. So they understood that fuel in the building in the basement or anywhere would be a bad idea, so I commend them for that. But the fire chief and the building inspector both picked up it has to be ventilated.
Yeah.
So there's an example of a relatively simple fix. Mm-hmm. And again, if you remember, this is a building that has not had any kind of facilities oversight ever. So now that facilities is involved and public safety and the building inspector, I'm sure we can make some changes. It's difficult to blame the staff for using the building improperly when no one told them that.
Yeah.
Going forward, we'll use it properly.
But I think what John's point is, after the fire chief and building inspector have gone through it, we will emerge with no unsafe use of the building.
Correct. Or we will close the building.
Or we'll close the or right.
Okay. So no monies need be committed in this article to continue the function of that.
As I sit here today, that's correct. If it changes, I'll certainly let you know.
So a valid... go ahead, John.
And just so, not to misinterpret what I'm saying, this is not about blame. This is not about saying that the staff is doing something.
Process.
I just think that it sounds like there's a much easier, straightforward way to resolve some of these issues without spending $2 million.
And that's exactly why I want the Cemetery Board of Trustees to come in and meet with us. So I think one simple way the board could, since we don't know the cost of design funds and we're not even sure that we need to design another facility, is to simply vote to not support the article tonight and let the conversation go from there. That might send the clearest message. Instead of, you know, doing in-between things, we don't know that we need to do a design. We might be able to do other interim measures without having to design a new facility. I say reject the article.
Bob? To the matter of Article 13 not specifying a site, as a practical matter, how would you possibly act on it if it were passed?
Right. Well, properly, it should be the permanent building committee's role
correct,
at this
correct.
Point. That's they were designed. They
true, but even that aside, how would you act on it?
We do have some old studies. The DPW yard and the cemetery issue were studied years ago, not too long ago.
Yeah.
And two locations were selected. So, but the point is, this article doesn't choose between them.
Exactly.
So there are two legitimate, if you will, locations, and the costs would be different for each. The pluses and minuses would be different. Staff had an opinion of it years ago, but I do not have an opinion, and I don't think the board had an opinion.
Well, we just heard in our meeting briefly with the Permanent Building Committee that they believe this is very difficult to proceed with without knowing the site. There are a number of factors that have not been looked into.
Right. So the sites are identified, but the type of facility built there and the cost of each is not identified.
Right. Okay, Barry.
I mean, I think given clearly using the building as it's currently constituted, ultimately there's going to be changes that need to be made. Whether that means that we build it somewhere else, rebuild it on its current location, look at shutting it down and moving the use to another site, there's a lot of work that needs to go into that. But ultimately something needs to get done. So I don't think we should vote Article 13 as it is, but I think that we should at least give credence to the fact that at some point we're going to have to deal with it. And now that we have a permanent building committee that's been seated, I don't think it's inappropriate for us to reserve a modest sum of money to be used for a study at some point when the building committee has a chance to do it, so that we're showing town meeting that we understand that there's something that needs to be done. We don't want to spend $2 million on something without any kind of study, but that we realize that it's something that needs to be dealt with. And so,
But are we here to solve that problem? This is their article. They should be presenting evidence and all these things to
Again,
us.
This is just our position. Yeah. They're going to go ahead and say whatever
I'm
they want
to
say.
I'm starting a conversation with this vote. That's what I'm trying to do. If it takes this to get them to come in, it'll go to the, in the warrant report is voting no, and then we can make a report on the, if we have a subsequent successful meeting and we resolve this more amicably, we can say we will support a smaller dollar amount.
But if we,
we don't have that information tonight.
No,
you
but
won't
if
have
we,
it from print.
No. Yeah. Well, and that's why I'm saying that if it goes to town meeting with the Board of Selectmen just voting no,
with
I think
some verbiage.
I think the town meeting was going to want to know that, you know, sort of our position on it, not just no.
I think what you just, and I think you could probably write that, right, if we voted no.
And town meeting would ask that of us anyway.
Yeah.
I think any time that we've ever voted something no, they've asked for a background reason as to why.
I think FinCom will ask me next week.
Yeah.
For an explanation of your vote.
Yeah.
So I'd have to write it up for
and
them.
And they may have their own.
Yeah.
Right. Mechanically, since Article 13 describes a path, a funding source, and a purpose for the money, is the right action to recast the article or simply take a contrary position?
I say contrary.
You know, it's going to ultimately be up to the moderator to decide how it can be modified.
Mm-hmm.
So the contrary position makes it clear with an explanation.
Okay.
Yes.
I don't see any sense of you trying to
we can't fix
reinvent
it
the article now.
Right.
That's
right.
Going to be a task for the moderator and town council to grapple
with. And negotiation with the board. Quite frankly, and the PBC needs to be. They're going to have to meet a couple times on this. So
they may have the PBC may have their own cut at it.
They may.
I would be in favor, just to put a straw man on the table. I'd be in favor of appropriating a sum of funds, and somebody else more wiser in the area of such topics can nominate the number to fund initial design studies to both evaluate the best use and best location and best method of reconstituting, if necessary, the cemetery garage, either on its current location or any of the other potential locations. And the purpose of the study ought to be to both evaluate the building and evaluate the other sites and return to the board with a set of conclusions. The permanent building committee would be a beneficiary of that. They'd probably actually sponsor that design study.
So what's the position on the article you're advocating?
I would take a position contrary to 13. 13 to me seems to be a ready, fire, aim approach.
Yes.
Not
yes.
to pick on Article 14
right.
for a minute.
Right. no, that was ready, aim, fire. That
yeah.
was done correctly.
But it really it speaks to an action without having gotten the right. preparatory steps in place. But I'd be fine with a much smaller sum of money to do the design study. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what sum of money such an analysis would take. I don't know whether it's a few tens of thousands or whether it's more.
I'm just trying to figure out how you're going to make a motion on that.
Well, for tonight, I would simply take a position contrary to 13 okay. that a design study
that's
is more
that's
appropriate.
That's my point, yeah.
Bob?
Another path. I think it's going to be difficult to craft 13 into something other than what it is.
Yeah.
We can work on it in advance, but I think another approach is in Article 5, just fund in the budget design money. That's how the schools have done it in the past.
You mean
past.
Three?
I don't think it needs to be capital. It could be, but I don't think it's necessary.
So it doesn't need to be
so
reduced.
It could be added to the capital plan, but it's real simple to just throw in a number in Article 5 and say, you know, we have to decide where it belongs and
oh,
what
okay.
line item, but in such and such a line item, I would say facilities department,
mm-hmm.
There's a sum of X number of dollars for the whatever it is we described for the cemetery garage.
So that would give a
And that way 13 can just, yeah. if you will, go away without any argument about wording and anything else. And there's an understanding at town meeting that money has just been set aside for the purpose you've discussed.
So if five passes with that
right.
X dollars in there, 13 then becomes moot.
So I would
point.
Assume so.
Well, maybe not.
Maybe not.
or they could move to take it out of order if they
yeah.
wanted to.
Yeah.
Well,
and then
right
debate
the
it.
Capital
and then
plan.
But if it's design money only, I don't think it's necessary to put it in the capital plan. You can, it doesn't
yeah.
really matter.
Yeah. Well, showing the $2 million, we would also want to take a position to take the $2 million out, I think.
Yeah.
Because that shouldn't be sitting in there if it's not.
Yeah.
Right. At least we would not want to see it.
Well, if we vote, right, if it's taken out of the capital plan, then 13 is automatically defeated.
Well, and I think
right.
for an explanation,
yes.
your explanation belongs in Article 3 because that's where
yes.
people are going to read it first.
Yeah.
And then you can already just report the vote in 13. You don't need the explanation.
All right. Why don't let's go back to 13 and have a motion. We could use the motion as written, I guess. So. We're going to have more discussion after the motion is made.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 13 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Second.
Okay. You have to second it if you're not going to vote for it.
Well, we should
vote. Actually, we should take a position.
Yeah, it should take a position.
Is there further discussion? Is it the board's intent to vote in the negative here and then pursue, if need be, the alternative of a design amount under Article 5?
Yes, at least for me.
Okay. All right, I will poll the board then if there's not further.
Yep.
Okay, Mr. Arena?
Yes, I vote the course of action you described.
Well, you're voting no.
Sorry, I vote no on Article 13, excuse me.
Mr. Berman?
No.
Mr. Sexton?
No.
Mr. Ensminger? No. Mr. Halsey?
No on Article 13.
Okay, that is a 0-5 vote. The motion does not carry.
Do you want to go back to Article 3?
That's a good place.
Yep. Let's go back to 3. Somebody want to attempt a motion there? We do want to support it, but with the amount for the garage.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 3 minus the $2 million for the cemetery garage as debt and other sources of funding.
Okay.
Of the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Second.
Seconded. Okay. Discussion. All in favor? Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Now we can proceed with the other articles now. 4.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 4 to the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Yeah, that's the improvement of the payment of prior year's bills. Any further discussion? Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes.
And Mr. Arena
Halsey?
Seconded that motion.
Yes, on Article 4.
Okay. Go ahead.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 5 to the 2015 subsequent town meeting.
Okay, second. That's the amending of the FY, is that seconded?
Yes.
Amending of the FY16 budget, and we can revisit that as need be for design money. So we'll be on record supporting it.
So do we want to add in that now, or do we?
I wouldn't know what to add.
I think the best way is under Article 3, explain that you would support an addition in Article 5 of funding.
During your discussion.
That just leaves it all clean in one place.
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
So that doesn't require a vote. That's just going to be part of our explanation of our vote.
Yes.
On Article 3.
And an amendment in Article 5.
Correct.
But then we still need to amend Article 5 now?
Well, you do it on the floor.
Because we don't know the number.
Yeah.
Just approve it.
That may emerge from PBC Cemetery Trustees.
You may have it the night of town meeting and we'll amend the town meeting.
We've got a month to get that number. Right. And you can change the motion at the last minute.
Yep. Well, just amend it on the floor.
I mean, we're really just supporting the general subject matter here, okay. Anyway, because that could change again from what you see tonight.
And also, it is FinCom's motion, so next week they could just pick a number.
They could do it for you.
Yeah.
Right.
All right. So is that motion amended and seconded?
It was.
Seconded already.
Further discussion on 5, Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena? Yes. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey on Article 5?
Yes, on Article 5.
Thank you. Article 6.
Move the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 6 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Second.
This is the road acceptances for Causeway Road, Corey Lane, Dividence Road, Pondview Lane, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way. Any further discussion? Mr. Berman?
Do we make the motion and second?
We just did.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Then yes.
Yep. Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes, on Article 6.
Very good. Okay. Any desire? I'm assuming the board is fine with skipping 7 through 9. And Article 10 would be the zoning bylaw changes for CPDC and ZBA associate members. I would recommend we take a position.
I would recommend that as well.
Okay, is there a motion?
No, not yet.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 10 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting.
Second.
Okay, discussion. Hearing none, poll the board. Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes, Mr. Halsey on Article 10?
Yes, on Article 10.
Thank you. Article 11.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 11 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
That's second. Okay, again, this is the bylaw changes to Section 3314, removal for absence. Further discussion? We'll take the vote. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes, on Article 11.
Okay. Article 12.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 12 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Okay, seconded. Again, this is the settling of potential litigation on the Sutton Brook disposal site. There's further discussion. All in favor, Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes, on Article 12.
Okay. 13, mm-hmm. We have done.
Done. Skipping to 14.
Article 14, is there a motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 14 of the 2015 subsequent town meeting.
Second.
Seconded. For the discussion. Poll the board. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. Mr. Halsey?
Yes, on Article 14.
Thanks. That completes the business on the November town meeting warrant articles. So we have one.
Can I just ask a question?
Sure.
Can I work with two of you between now and the end of the week to craft some language to explain to FinCom?
I'll be happy to.
Maybe Barry and Dan, since you were with the Permanent Building Committee.
Yep.
Okay, thanks.
Yep. Very good.
When is their meeting?
Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
When does this go to press, Bob?
Yeah. The Thursday after FinCom meets.
Okay. Yep. All right, we have one other item, review of the 2016 Board of Selectmen meeting schedule. Should be in your packet. At least we have dates through June, what I saw. Is that in the hand? Yes, here it is.
Okay. So it's just a good idea for the board to publish a schedule, and we'd only gone through December. Mm-hmm. I will note right up front that it looks like you're going to need to have, you are going to need to have three meetings in January, maybe fourth with a financial forum. Mm-hmm. And that's because the election was moved up to close, and the warrant also has to get moved up.
Okay. Right. Yep.
To January 26th.
So we'll be meeting weekly pretty much. Soon.
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah, except for New Year's.
Comes with the job.
And then
wasn't advertised.
Yeah. Unadvertised special. The blue light special. Barry.
We'll be snowed out of two of them. Don't worry about it, Barry.
And then it's just pretty much twice a month, every other week.
Right. Okay.
Trying to skip things like school vacation.
Yep. Yeah, I don't see any issues.
Do we want to assign office hours, or do you just?
You guys can do that and let us know. We generally just rotate.
Yeah.
And just keep rotating on the current.
Rotate after March 1st.
Why don't you guys give Bob, you travelers, give him any days where you can't be here for office hours?
Unfortunately, it's hard to tell. But.
Well, if you know. If you don't, we'll work. We always work it out. We can
jump substitute.
In. Yeah. So just set something up. We'll meet it. Okay. All right. Any further question? Anything else to come before the board this evening? I think we've completed all business.
I just have a quickie that's. My wife, who's a CPA, brought to my attention that Lieutenant Governor Karen Polito will be speaking Tuesday, October 20th from 8 to 10 in Peabody City Hall on the subject of Massachusetts Community Compact, a way of strengthening the governor's office with communities. Mm. Karen Polito herself will be speaking. I'm not sure if any of you are interested in going. It's here. It's a nominal fee to attend.
Okay.
But
is it during the day or evening?
It's during the day.
Okay. Let's see. Who do we contact here if we're interested?
Bob, if you were intending on going or you'd heard about this previously.
I think I heard about it, and I think I have a union meeting.
Yeah, I know Karen, the governor's relying on Lieutenant Governor Polito to be an important liaison with local selectmen and mayors. She's had a deep interest in that. So it might be worth going. I'll have to see it. Let's see. Tuesday.
October 20th. Tuesday the
20th. Shoot Paula and or I an email if any of you want to go.
That's in the morning?
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
8 a.m.
We have a selectman's meeting that evening.
Yeah. Right.
Correct.
Okay. I will let you know. So what's the time on that again?
8 to 10.
8 to 10 a.m.
Anybody, City Hall?
Yes.
Thank you. Anything else for the board tonight? I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
Move the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at...
Call it 8:59.
Quarter of one.
Eight fifty-nine p.m.
Second.
Okay, we'll pull the board by roll. Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? And Mr. Yes, and Mr. Halsey?
I'm going to say yes, but I also would like to know, if I stay away, will we always be done by 9 o'clock?
Probably.
Well, if you're noting the correlation, I never said that. But
hey, John, you know my position. I've told you this many times.
I know. Okay. Thanks for cooperating with me at this distance. Appreciate it.
Thanks, John. I'll call you regarding our earlier session.
Get better fast, buddy.
Okay. Hang in.
Good night, everybody.
Where's the off on this?
John, do you want to hang up? Do you want this back?
Okay. No.